Thank you. declared what he hath done for my soul. I cried unto him with my mouth, and he was extolled. With my tongue, God, I don't know the word I just asked for. Lord, that you take this message, Lord, and move upon. Lord, if you just let it come out of my mouth, Lord, as you brought it to me, God. And Lord, hide me behind the cross, Lord. Lord, I don't want my face to be known, but just you. Lord, you just, Lord, take this message, Lord, and spread it. Let it come upon our hearts, Lord. Receive it. The same as I do. Now, I don't want to talk about testimony. A testimony is something that God has brought you through and you have came out of stronger. It's given us something to talk about and someone out there is going through the same thing that you just came out of or what God has brought you from in the past. A testimony means evidence. Is there evidence in your testimony? So why aren't you saying it? A spiritual meaning, a way in which God has shown up in a person's life, which is to teach them, to remind them of something he promised. Sometimes it's just the nature of prayer. It can be a testimony. Anything that we go through, anything God has done for us is a testimony. In Luke 8:39, return to thine own house and show how great things God hath done unto thee. And when he went his way and published throughout the whole city how great things Jesus had done unto him. And this he's talking about when Jesus cast all the demons out of him. And told him to go back and tell the world of what wonderful things God has done. We're all sitting here because we're divine purposes to be here.
Amen.
We have a mission to go do. But our mission can't succeed without our testimony. Because our testimonies is what reaches the lost. Our testimony is what reaches the ones that's out here on drugs. Every one of us in here has had something we've been addicted to.
Amen.
And I tell you, God loves that addicts. Because they're already committed to something and they give their whole heart to it. So God loves them. So don't turn them away. Don't judge. When someone walks up to you, or you walk by someone, and they're running their mouth and they're cursing, do you instantly judge? They shouldn't do that. You shouldn't talk like that. Stop it. Stop. God's dealt with me with this. Stop. Pray for them right there. I asked some of you all a question Monday. Some of you all and they thought, this man has lost his mind. By the way I worded it. Just hold on. You ain't seen anything yet. It's just the beginning. Because my mind no longer belongs to me. I've surrendered my mind. It's sold out to him, to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. It's his. Now the question that I ask some of you all is, where can I find this man named Jesus? And once I find him, how do I keep him? He is in every breath we breathe, with every beat of our hearts. His blood, white as snow, flows through our bodies. With every blink of an eye, we are 1 second closer to the coming of him. And with the sound of our voice calling upon his name, he is there. He is living in us. As soon as you breathe, he is there. All you have to do is call upon his name. And ask him to forgive you all of your sins. And ask him to come in and save your soul. and change you. Change. Yes, there will be a change. Because once he enters, evil and Jesus don't mix. They do not operate in the same vessel. So get enough of him in you, because fear trembles of his name. So when his presence is there, fear has to flee. And receive. That's the biggest one. You have to receive him. And confess with your mouth that Jesus has come in and saved your soul. Hallelujah. And how you keep him is in prayer. Spending time with him in prayer. Not about your needs. Or just about your needs. Constantly having conversation with him in your daily walk. People might think you're crazy, but we in here are not people pleasers.
Amen.
So have a praise in your heart. Have a praise on your voice constantly for what he's done. Seek him in your decisions, no matter what it may be. Loving everyone and having forgiveness, the same as he had forgiveness for us when we come through the cross. I don't know why I'm on this, but God led this to me and made me write this down. Men, love your wives as the same as he does the church. Women, you're not out of it either. Love your husband. Treat him as he is the head of the house. Men, you are not the boss, but you are the head, the protector. Get it right. It's time to straighten up. We as brothers and sisters should be concerned about sinners. If you go a day or days without that on your heart, you may be lost or on your way. I'm sorry, but not sorry. So go sit at the Father's feet a while. See what he has to say about that. He'll answer you if you ask. We should be concerned, even the ones that have left. Even the ones talking about you, present talking about you. The ones sowing seeds of discord, or the ones that will eat you up to your face and stab you in the back as soon as you turn away. Are you praying in agreement with your brothers and sisters for them? Guilty. I haven't been. Everyone in here is guilty because we haven't been. I've not seen any of us gather around and pray for the ones that walked out of here. Wholeheartedly, like we do about some things. Are you calling their names out in your secret place? Are you praying for strength like Samson when the covers hold them down and they can't get up? Are you praying that God takes away that stony heart and turns it to nothing but love? Are we praying for the lies to come to an immediate stop and nothing but the truth come out of that lying mouth? Are we praying that Satan can't come in and torment their minds anymore? That God floods their mind with peace and joy. And the Word. Most importantly, the Word. Or are you sowing some seed yourself? Not the good seeds. It's time to come out of the mentality, get before you get God. Because if you got Jesus, you're going to get praying because the devil ain't got them yet. There are tiny ears that hear us, here or not in here. And there are new ears coming in. And there are eyes that see everything that we do, whether it be our eyes or God's eyes.
Amen.
Have you asked your brothers and sisters what he has done for you today? Just randomly. Guilty. I have not. Better yet, have we told anyone what he's done for us? How long of a gap is it before we tell someone of what he's done for us? What about a stranger? Complete stranger. He says that we are to go out and spread the gospel. We are to go out and tell others about him. Are we doing it? Truly? Guilty, I'm not. I haven't been. But with repentance, there's change. And I've repented. Don't let fear rise up to go talk to a stranger, a complete stranger, someone you don't know. Be like David. You could be exactly what they need to hear right then and there by your testimony. There is power. God brought you through it, so you know it's powerful. You know it has something behind it. When God brings you through it, and you're stronger, and you're better, and you excel. There's power behind that. But we're not going out here and telling people, guys, open your eyes, look around. You can see what they're going through. And 70% of it, or better, is exactly what the majority of us in here has done went through. But we just don't want to open up. See, we say, let God out of the box. Let Jesus out of the box. We're hoarding him in here. He's not just for us. He's for every soul out there. Saved, not saved. But we want to hold him here. We want to take what he's done for us and hold it. We don't want to let that go. But once you let it go, he's got something greater coming. He's got another testimony for you that's greater than the last one. In 2 Timothy 1, verse 8, do not blush or be ashamed, then to testify and for our Lord, none of me, a prisoner for his sake, but with me, take your share of the suffering to which the preaching, this is the Amplified, of the gospel may expose you, do it in the power of God. See, God did not give us a spirit of timidity or cowardness or a cringing fear, but he has given us a spirit of power and love and a calm and well-balanced mind. If you ain't a well-balanced minded person, cast that spirit of double-mindedness out of you right now. It's time to get a little more spiritual about us than just the cardinal eyes or, well, I don't want to go to church today. Then you sit there 15 minutes. Well, I should have been there. That's a double-minded person. Get out of it. Come on. Either get on board or get help. Help is here. You ain't got to call 911. Call on God. Call on your brothers or sisters. I've done it.
Amen.
I've been 12 o'clock at night, and I've been up to my pastor's house. Pastor, I've got a problem. I need help with this. Stop being ashamed. Shame is a liar. Shame is something of the enemy. And you just, and every one of us lets it sit and work in us without stopping and thinking, this ain't God. I'm getting out of here. Or do you just not want him? He bore that for us. He went to the cross for that for us. And God made us disciplined. And God gave us self-control. Are you walking in that identity that you say you are all the time? or just the good parts when you're around your brothers or sisters in Christ? It is easy to resist the urges of the flesh and world when you're surrounded by them. That's why it is so important for us to all gather. But is that the same identity that you're walking in when you're around your buddies, your work people, or family members that don't know Christ? Are you that same person? Most important, are you that same person when you're alone?
Come on.
When you're alone, you ain't got anyone around you to stop the temptations, to stop the thoughts. You have no one to sit and talk to but Jesus. Are you seeking Him? Are you spiritually disciplined when you're alone? Are you spiritually disciplined when you're at work? If you do something, does God immediately correct you? Or does He just let it slide? You're going to have to stop and think about that for a minute. If He's not correcting you around your work buddies or old Tom Joe down here who just chugged a six-pack and you making some nasty jokes, if He's not correcting you, there's something wrong. You need to stop and think. Are you spiritual disciplined enough or discerned enough to stop Satan in his tracks on the spot? Or are you just giving in a little? Are you sitting and saying in your mind, this little thing won't hurt. No one's around. Well, stop it. This ain't no midnight snack at 12 o'clock.
Come on.
It will hurt you. It is life or death. Even the smallest things are life and death. No sin is greater than another. So stop. If you're riding the fence, but you know if you are or not, your fence is about to break. And every which one you're serving is the one that weighs the most. And you're going to fall on that side. Because God is cutting the ones that don't need to be here. God is cutting the true from the liars. God is placing the remnant and growing the remnant. He's getting ready to move. If you can't see it, just look around.
Amen.
Look around. And I don't know why, but be weary of who you listen to. A piece of paper does not ordain you to send you to heaven. There are so many people out here now who is going and getting ordained to be a minister. If God didn't send you, I'm sorry, but you better sit down or He's going to strike you down. I don't know who's listening that's doing it, but you better take heed to what I'm saying. Now that's out of the way. We know the sacrifices that it took to get where we are now. So don't stop. Are you willing to keep going? Don't stop. Even the most gorgeous bodies of water, if they sit still long enough, they get stagnant. Even the biggest bodies of water, once they sit still, they will get stagnant. So keep pressing. Don't stop praying. Don't stop fasting, praying, reading, praying, listening, praying, building your relationship with Him, praying a little more, praying, preaching, worshiping, prophesying, hearing, teaching, marching on, and riding on, and praying some more. Going forward in this make up your mind. There's going to be more. You're going to have to get a little more discipline about yourself, including me. I'm not out of this, guys. I'm not sitting dab in the middle of this. because I'm still dealing with it, and he's still dealing with me over it. But there's going to be more discipline with us. There's going to be more self-control, and there's going to be more of a Christ-like mind that we have to receive. Even though we've received Christ, we still haven't received everything that he wants, because we cancel it. We say, no, that's no, no, ain't doing that. We don't want to receive it. We say we want to get closer and closer to God and closer to God. But we don't want to take his correction. Sometimes his correction is to push back an extra meal or read an extra hour. Or go talk to this guy or go talk to this woman. I'm like, no. How are you going to get closer if you can't be obedient? How are you going to get closer if you don't have discipline? So stay focused and be ready to share your testimonies. Don't forget where he brought you from. Don't forget where he pulled you out of. Where you didn't think there was no way, he made a way. Always remember that. We all get caught up in this present time, and we're waiting on the day that Jesus comes. But there is work to do until breath leaves your body, or he comes back. You should be excited. We all should be excited that God has called us. He's called us to do something. Even if it is taking out the trash, I would still be excited, because God has called me to take out that trash. So keep marching and keep expanding heaven. Keep praying with all you got. Keep worshiping with all you got. Keep preaching with all you got. Testify with all you got. Give your testimonies with all you got. It's yours. God gave it to you. And every one of our testimonies are different. Everyone. In Romans 8:31, I don't think I gave this one to you. What then shall we say to this? If God is for us, then who can be against us? You know, we forget about the little testimonies, the little things that God has done for us. We forget about that. And those little ones, the ones that we forget about, is so little to us, but can be so big for someone else. Because we're all created in God's image. We are all created differently, but have the same purpose in life. So if Ernie's going through something, it may be small to him, but to me, it could be the most dramatic thing of my life. But we forget about those. If we want to reach him, we got to tell him. Not only about his love, but about what he can do, about what he has done, about who he is. A lot of times we get caught up in this world. We get caught up in some things that we want done. Even though it may seem like it's God, don't forget, Satan has tactics too. Just for every one of us, because I'm guilty of it myself. For something that you want, we really need to seek God about it. Because like I say, Satan has tactics too, and he'll give you what you want. And in the end, he'll turn around and bite you. Same as the one out here talking about you. I love you, and that's what God gave me. I hope it helps someone. Even if it is just a reminder. Sometimes we all need a reminder.
Yeah, every day.
Because we all forget.